Hello friends, in today's lecture, we will try to distinguish between living things and non-living things. And we will strive to understand why the cell is called as a unit of life. We have classified all the objects in two broad categories. The first category is called as living things and the second category is called as non-living things. We know that the living organisms, they show following characteristics. So if the organism or the object, if it is a living one, then it will definitely have respiration. This is the process in which the food, it is digested, it is oxidized, and the energy is produced. So all living organisms, they show the characteristic that is respiration. The second characteristic is that the organism, living one, it will show growth, and the growth, it will be irreversible growth. If we have a balloon and if we fill air in the balloon it will swell up, okay. And if we release the gas, then again the balloon it will shrink. This growth, that is the swelling of the balloon, it is a reversible process, and that is why it is not the growth. On the other hand, in the living organisms, there will be a change which is a permanent change, irreversible change, and such a change is called as growth. For example, the green leaves, they turn to be yellow or red. The green fruits, after ripening, they change their color. Okay. So whatever changes are there, these changes are irreversible, and that is why it is a growth. The living organisms will also need nutrition, because for their all physiological activities, they will need energy. And this energy, it is provided by the food, and this absorption or production of the food is called as a nutrition. So accordingly, the living organisms may produce their own food autotrophic, for example the plants, or they may acquire nutrition from other sources, that is heterotrophic. The living organisms, they will also show reproduction. So they have a tendency to produce number of individuals which are similar to the parent one, and this process is called as reproduction. And finally, the living organisms, they show a locomotion, that is movement, either from one direction to another direction or from one place to another place. So these are the characteristics of living being. If the object do not show either of these characteristics, then it is called as non-living. Now we will take an example of a vehicle. Suppose we have a two-wheeler. And this two-wheeler, it requires energy for movement. So what we will do? We will add a fuel in this vehicle. And that fuel, it will serve as a source of energy. Now once this vehicle, it is started, it will move from one place to another place. Say for example, from A to B. Now as this vehicle, it shows locomotion, as it requires energy, whether we will call it as a living being? No. Because even though the vehicle, it moves from one place to another place, it requires somebody to drive on. The vehicle cannot move with its own will. And that is why this vehicle, even it moves from one place to another place, it is a non-living thing. Or we can take example of resin, which is put in hot water. After putting in hot water, it will swell up, and after drying, it will again shrink. And this movement, here it shows increase in its volume, even though it appears to be similar to growth, it is not called as growth, because it is a reversible process. And therefore the resins, they do not show growth and they are non-living things. Okay.
So this is the difference between living and non-living things. So on the basis of these parameters, we can divide the organisms, the objects in two broad categories. Now coming towards the definition of a cell. Cell is defined as structural and functional unit of life.
Cell is structural and functional unit of life.
Now why it is called as a structural unit and a functional unit? Now before that, we will try to understand what is mean by unit.
Is the smallest structure or it is the smallest form in which a particular thing appears.
Okay. Suppose we have a water, 1 liter. If we remove a small fraction of this water, say for example 1 ml,
will it be water or something else?
It will remain water. If we cut it down into smaller fraction and we come to a smaller amount in microns, micrometers, it will remain water till it has this structure, that is H2O. It will be the unit. So water, it will show all its characteristic, all the characteristic of water when it is present in this smallest form. So this is the smallest possible form of water, that is H2O. If we split hydrogen and oxygen, it will be released, and now the hydrogen and oxygen will be separate and they will not show the characteristic of water. So this is the smallest form where water can occur. Okay, H2O. So H2O is called as a water. Similarly, coming towards living organisms, what is the smallest structure which can be isolated from that organism? It will show the characteristic of life. Okay, so that fraction we need. Now we will take an example of a plant. Suppose this is a huge tree. It is growing somewhere in the forest.
Is it living or dead?
Yes, it is living thing.
Suppose I cut a branch of this tree and I have separated this branch. Whether it is living or dead, still it is a living one.
Okay, still this branch is a living branch. So it is a living one. Suppose I separated this twig and we have taken a fraction of this branch.
It is green. It has sufficient amount of moisture. And we put it in a soil for germination.
Whether this branch is living or dead? Yes, it is living or dead one? Yes, it is living.
So we can isolate the structure of this plant, the structure of this entire tree in smaller fraction, and we can come up to a structure which is called as a cell. And as long as we can have an intact cell, we can see the characteristic of life in this structure. This single cell, as long as it is intact in form of cell, it can show respiration, it will grow, it will show nutrition, it will show reproduction. So this cell, it will try to divide and redivide. The cell, it will show all the characteristic of life. So this is, now this is the smallest unit which can show the characteristic of life. And that is why this unit is called as the unit of life. Now what will happen if we cut this cell and make its fragments? Whether it will remain as a living being? No, it will not survive, and that's why it will become non-living. So cell is the smallest possible form in which life can survive. This is the smallest possible form in which the life may be present. And we are familiar with number of such examples. We have seen the bacteria. They are unicellular structures and still they are living. We have cyanobacteria, prokaryotic organisms. We can have example of unicellular fungi like as yeast. So they are surviving even though their structure, their body, it is made up of a single cell. And that is why a cell is called as a unit of life. The entire body, structurally, it is made up by cells. And therefore, cell is called as a structural unit. Similarly, the physiological activities, whatever they are going on in the body, they are the result of the activity of each cell. Certain cells, they are carrying out photosynthesis. Certain cells, they are transporting the food. Certain cells are absorbing water and transporting the water. In certain tissue, in certain cells, the reserve food material, excess food material, it will sink down and it will be stored in the form of either seeds or the fruits or the tubers. So in this way, all the cells, they are functionally active. And the sum total of all the functions of all the cells results in the appearance of that particular organism. That is why the cell is called as a structural unit as well as it is called as a functional unit. And this is the basis of cell theory. So this is for today. For more such videos, don't forget to subscribe my channel. And comment in the section below if you have any doubts. Thank you.